Welcome to MA3D1, the Warwick Maths module on fluid mechanics. This video is about the deformation of infinitesimal fluid elements. This is a fairly important topic and this is going to be a long video. I strongly recommend that you take your time to watch through this video, pause wherever you need to, work out all the details because I'm going to, in the interest of time, I'm going to not clutter the screen with manipulations that you can easily do yourself. Okay, so let's begin. Why study the deformation of infinitesimal fluid elements? Well, firstly, because the definition of the fluid itself invokes a property of the fluid as something that can undergo continuous deformation. So we need a way to quantify it. On top of the definition of the fluid, we have also seen that internal stresses in the fluid develop in response to the deformation, for example, Newtonian law of viscosity. And therefore, it is important to quantify the rate at which the fluid is deforming. You can also look at the deformation of finite volumes, and in a sense we have developed some machinery for doing that, for example how to track Lagrangian volumes. But for the sake of fluids, and because we are going to apply conservation laws, especially of mass and momentum, to infinitesimal volumes of fluid, it will suffice for us to examine how infinitesimal fluid elements deform. In any case, the general finite volume can be considered to be a collection of infinitesimal volumes, and the deformation of the finite volume can then be considered as a collection of the infinitesimally deforming volumes. This is a step that is not critical to generalize to finite volumes. It's hardly ever needed. Plus, we have results like the Reynolds transport theorem that we saw in one of the previous videos, in the video on Lagrangian and Eulerian descriptions. So this video is, we will be limiting to deformation of infinitesimal fluid elements. It turns out there is a lot here to cover. In the most general case, you can consider how neighboring points in an infinitesimal volume are transported by the flow, because this transport is what will ultimately give rise to the deformation. There are only a few modes of deformation. Although the volume can change shape, and finite volume can change shape in countless number of ways, maybe even uncountable number of ways. But an infinitesimal volume, the modes of deformation, at least their description, can be treated in a very limited way, yet be very general. In order to see that, let's consider how fast a neighboring fluid element would be moving relative to a reference fluid element. So let's say this is the vector x, this is the point x, and we are going to look at another point which is separated from x by an amount delta x. In this infinitesimal fluid volume, and therefore delta x is expected to be vanishingly small. In that case, the fluid the velocity of x plus delta x can be found by Taylor expanding the expression in an Eulerian description to get the velocity at x plus the gradient of the velocity multiplied by this small separation vector delta x. Now this expression is written in index notation. There is a repeated index j in the second term, so that means there is a sum implied over j. Now what we are going to do is we are going to write this gradient of velocity. velocity is a first rank tensor, it's a vector, so first rank tensor. Its gradient adds another index, so become the gradient is a second rank tensor. It has two indices, I and j. I denoting the component of velocity and j denoting the component of the gradient. Now what we are going to do is decompose the velocity gradient tensor into two, R ij plus Eij, where R is the anti-symmetric part of the velocity gradient tensor. The anti-symmetric part is found by taking the velocity gradient, transposing it, which means exchanging I and j and subtracting. And you can verify that this satisfies the definition of anti-symmetry. Rij is minus Rji. In vector notation, R is written as 1/2 gradient of u minus gradient of u transpose. So that's the anti-symmetric part, and the symmetric part is denoted Eij, which is formed by taking the sum of the gradient of u and gradient of u transpose, which is written in index notation in this form. Okay, and by substituting this gradient as a sum of these two terms, now the single term that we started with now becomes two terms, Rij delta Ij, Eij delta Ij. And now we are going to attribute some interpretation to each of these three terms, because in these three terms are what we can use to characterize the deformation of the whole volume, because delta x, we have just taken it to be an arbitrary vector within this volume, right? So it turns out that R, the anti-symmetric part of the velocity gradient tensor, is a rate of rotation tensor, right? In order to see that, note that because R is anti-symmetric, it has only three independent components out of the possible nine. And this is something that you should be able to see yourself, you know, treat it as a mini homework problem. And therefore, the components of R can be written in terms of the third rank alternating tensor. Now, the exact form is this, Rij equals epsilon ijk times omega k. And you can easily see that if you transpose I and j, then the epsilon ijk changes sign, and therefore you get the negative of your original expression, thereby proving, at least in one direction, that Rij is anti-symmetric. Any anti-symmetric tensor could be written in this form. Now, if I substitute this Rij in the expression for the velocity of a neighboring point, what you will find is that Rij delta Xj has that form, and you will remember this form from the cross product. This is nothing but the cross product of the delta x of the relative position vector with the vector omega, which we introduced in this form. In fact, this form of cross product is reminiscent of a rigid body rotation, velocity because of rigid body rotation. In fact, it turns out that indeed, if you consider a body, a rigid body rotating with angular velocity capital omega, then the velocity of that body is given by delta x cross omega r. Therefore, this expression denotes nothing more than the velocity of a body rotating rigidly with angular velocity omega. Now, at this point, I would like to make a connection that is very widely known and will help us understand a very important quantity in the future. And that quantity is the vorticity. vorticity is the curl of the velocity in the Eulerian description. Okay, and it's usually given the symbol omega. Vorticity is a vector, so omega has one underline. Now, the fact that the gradient of velocity appears in Rij, and if you also look at the form of vorticity, and here is your quick homework number two, write down the components of vorticity, write down the components of Rij, and convince yourself that indeed this vector omega, which can be used to express Rij, is 1/2 the vorticity. All right, and therefore, once you make this connection, you will note that vorticity is nothing but twice the rotation rate of this fluid element which we are studying, this infinitesimal fluid element. So we started with this infinitesimal fluid element, and every point in this element, every fluid particle in this element is moving at some speed. A contribution of the distribution of velocity in this element is for the rotation, the rigid body rotation of that element, and it comes from that term. Right? And now, given that we have identified rigid body rotation, now let's look at that expression again, but in vector notation. So the velocity at the neighboring point is the velocity at the reference point x. And this, it just amounts to translation, right? With time, the whole volume will translate with the speed of the reference point. The second term, we just showed that it corresponds to rigid rotation. So the second term gives rise to rotation of an infinitesimal element. And I've just drawn a rectangular element for simplicity here. So what we are left with is the third term. The third term is indeed responsible for deformation of this element. And by deformation, I mean a change of shape. Because rigid translation and rigid rotation does not change shape. So change in shape of the element, which is how we define deformation, only comes from the third term. And therefore, this expression, this symbol E, is called the rate of deformation tensor. Okay? And this rate of deformation tensor is going to be the subject of intense scrutiny from now on. The first observation is that the rate of deformation tensor is a symmetric tensor. And therefore, out of the 9 possible elements it can have, 3 of those are related. The 3 below the diagonal, let's say, are equal to the 3 above the diagonal, and therefore there are only 6 independent components of this tensor, and therefore one can interpret that as saying that there are only 6 independent modes of deformation. We can further classify these modes of deformation in terms of the diagonal elements, which are E11, E22, E33, and the off-diagonal elements, E12, E13, E23. Okay, and each one of them has a simple interpretation. For example, it is easy to see that E11, and if you write it in terms of the velocity gradient, you will see that it is equal to partial u partial x, where u, v, w are the components, are the Cartesian components of the Eulerian velocity u. Partial u partial x is nothing but the extensional strain rate along x. What does one mean by that? Well, let's say you started with a rectangular, nice rectangular element, which is still infinitesimal in size, and therefore its size is delta x by delta y. Now, if you move with this point A. So you move your reference frame with the point A so that the point A appears stationary. So relative to point A, this point, which I will call, let's say, B, point B will be moving in the horizontal direction given by partial u partial x times x. And it will be moving vertically upwards at the velocity partial v partial x times delta x. So if you look at what rate is the length of this element increasing, which means d dt of delta x, at what rate is this length increasing? You will find that it is obviously related to partial u partial x du dx times delta x. In fact, it is exactly equal to that. And if you look at the relative rate of extension of this box, the relative rate of extension means that you take the rate of extension and divide it by its original length, which was delta x. You find that that is equal to del u del x, which was E11. So the relative rate of extension has this special name, the extensional strain. Strain generally means the elongation relative to original length. Now, in our picture, the elongation is happening continually. And therefore, we not only have an extensional strain, but a rate of extensional strain, or an extensional strain rate, which is given by E11. And similarly, if you look at the rate at which the volume is extending along the y relative to its original length, you will get E22, and along z, you'll get E33. Now, we are ready for another important result, which is we can now quantify the rate at which the volume of this element is changing. Here are two simple calculations for you to work out. First, you should work this out, that the relative rate of change of the horizontal length delta x of the box is partial u partial x. And the second is, given that the volume of this box is delta x, delta y, delta z, and I haven't drawn delta z perpendicular to plane of the of this surface, the rate of change of the volume relative to the original volume, you can write it in this form. This is something you can derive by simple differentiation, right? So take a minute to do that. And each of these expressions are now the extensional strain rates along the three directions. So you get E11, E22, E33. This is nothing but the trace of our deformation rate tensor. So what this result means is that the relative rate of change of volume of an infinitesimal element, in this case a rectangular element, but later we are going to see that this also applies to element of arbitrary shape, right? We are not going to see that today, but we'll see it later. The relative rate of change of volume of an infinitesimal element is equal to the trace of the deformation rate tensor. Now, the trace of the deformation rate tensor, E11, E22, E33 added together, is also related to another quantity from differential calculus. It's equal to del u del x, del v del y plus del w del z. It's the sum of these three quantities, and that is known as the divergence of the velocity field of u. So the divergence of velocity is also equal to the relative rate of change of an infinitesimal volume. This type of cartoon you can use to derive this expression. Now, another mode of deformation to extension is shear. And here I have drawn a simple cartoon showing shear. if you start with a nice rectangular element in the beginning, then what the fluid flow can do is deform this element into this type of shape. And the rate of change of the angle of neighboring sides, theta in this case, is related to the off-diagonal elements of the deformation rate tensor, in this case E12. Now E12 is equal to E21 because of symmetry, and it's given by that expression. So this is in fact one of the examples in the example sheet number 2. So I'm not going to prove it here, and you will also you don't need to prove it here, you just take my word for it for now, because you will prove it in example sheet 2. Okay, so these off diagonal elements E12, 21, 133, 1 and E2, 3, 3, 2, what they do is they shear the element away from its rectangular shape. And it's not too hard to also prove, this is elementary geometry, that by this process they don't change the volume of the element. So if these are the only elements, components present in the deformation rate tensor, they don't change the volume of the element. Okay, so this is the first part of this video where we have examined carefully the different modes of deformation of an infinitesimal element. Welcome to the second part of the video. In the first part, we saw how the deformation of an infinitesimal fluid element can be understood in terms of a few modes. The two modes that we identified were extension and shear. In this video, or in this part of the video, I'm going to argue that these are really not two independent modes, but these are two faces of the same coin. In order to do that, I'm going to introduce two flows. The first flow, two examples of flows. The first flow is an extensional flow, where the components of velocity, these are simple examples, these make life easy. The components of velocity are simply given by x, minus y. And the second example is one with a shear flow, which I label a shear flow. Its components are u, v, are y, x. And therefore, if you calculate the deformation rate tensor, you will find that the deformation rate tensor of the extensional flow does not have any shear components. It has only two extensional components. And for the shear flow, the deformation rate does not have any extensional components, but only has shear components. Now I'm going to visualize for you the deformation of rectangular elements in these two flows. Okay. So let's get started. I just have to make sure. We will start with extensional flow. All right, let me run the program. There we go. Okay. So here, the Eulerian velocity field corresponding to the extensional flow is plotted with the arrows. Okay. As you can see, what this flow does is the further away you go from the origin along the x direction, the velocity of the fluid increases proportionally. And if you go to the left of the origin, then the velocity again increases proportionally, but in the opposite direction, in such a way that the fluid in between would be stretched along the x direction. Along the y direction, the story is completely opposite. As you go away from the origin above, the fluid velocity is the fluid velocity points downwards, and its magnitude increases the further away you go. If you go below, fluid velocity points upwards, again the magnitude increasing proportionally to the distance from the origin. So the influence of this velocity field on this square that I have drawn would be to squish it along y and to extend it along X. Let's see if that's what happens. As soon as I click on this figure, I have simulated the effect of this flow on this volume, and we are going to see the volume deforming according to what we expect. It did get squished along the vertical direction, and it got extended along the horizontal direction. Now let's see what a shear flow would do to this. I'm going to change the code to now repeat this process, but for a shear flow. And here it goes. Now here is a shear flow. Okay, what this shear flow does is it takes fluid elements from one corner and transports them to the other corner. Takes from the top left corner, transports them to the top right or the bottom left corner, depending on where exactly you start. Now, when I press, when I do a key press on this window, the simulation will restart and the element will be deformed by the flow. We will be able to see how the element is deformed by the flow. And you will see, you saw what happened to this rectangle, this square. The square got sheared. The angle between the sides of the square is no longer 90 degrees, and that was our definition of shear. Now, these are the two flows that typify the two modes of deformation I introduced earlier. But what if I told you that these are really the same modes of deformation? Well, clearly you see that these deform the squares differently. So on what basis am I saying that these are the same modes of deformation? Now I'm going to continue with using the shear flow, but what I'm going to do is I'm going to use a different square to begin with. Okay, and I will look at a square that is, as soon as I press enter, rotated 45 degrees to the coordinate axis. Okay, and I still have the shear flow pattern. You will recognize the shear flow pattern. And now I'm going to evolve the shape of this square under this flow, and you will see what happens to this square. This square got squished along one of the diagonals, and it got extended along the second diagonal. Got extended in that direction. Or I don't know which way you are seeing the video, but you know what I mean. So it looks like whether a volume is sheared or extended depends on the shape of that volume. And therefore, we have missed something, a small relation between shear and extension. Right? What could that be? Before we do that, before I explain what that relation is, I'm also going to show you the same sort of dynamics, same sort of deformation for the purely extensional flow. So here I have purely extensional flow. As you can see, the pattern is now reverted back to the extensional flow. And now I have a square which is rotated 45 degrees. So let me now press enter, and you will see how the volume deforms. The square deforms now by changing the angle between the elements, right? So, and this is completely intuitive because this sort of visualization, I hope, helps you appreciate that extension along one axis, which changes length, could also be used to change angles between lines, like we have done here, if the lines were rotated by 45 degrees to the original lines. Right? So there is something about the orientation of the volume that plays a role in the nature of the deformation, whether it is extension or shear. Right? So now let's go back to the writing tablet and let's clarify what's going on quantitatively. Now we saw that the deformation rate tensor was symmetric. Deformation rate tensor is symmetric. Let's find the eigenvalues and the eigenvectors of the matrix that makes up this tensor. All right, so we are going to write that as E times a vector V is equal to lambda times the vector V. All right, this will give us, when we solve this, this will give us the eigenvalues and the eigenvectors, because this is a 3x3 matrix corresponding to a second rank tensor. There will be three values, lambda 1, lambda 2, lambda 3, and corresponding three vectors v1, v2, v3, which will satisfy the eigenvalue relation. You can use, now because it is a symmetric matrix, the eigenvectors are orthogonal. And because they are orthogonal, now we can transform into a coordinate system, still an orthogonal coordinate system, along the three eigenvectors, which means we can say that E1, this is not the deformation rate tensor, E1 is the unit vector along the x direction, is A11 V1 hat, where V1 hat is the unit vector along the eigenvector V1, plus A12 V2 hat, A13 V3 hat, E2 equals A21 V1 hat, A22 V2 hat, plus A23 V3 hat, E3 equals A31 V1 hat, plus A32 V2 hat, plus A33 V3 hat. And all I've done is written down the transformation. Now it will so happen that when you transform E to the new coordinate system, and this new coordinate system is simply rotated with respect to the original coordinate system, because I have three orthogonal unit vectors again in the new coordinate system. So I will get new components of the deformation rate tensor, and I will call them E prime. It will so happen, because we have chosen the deformation in the new coordinate system in a very clever way, we will have E11 prime, E22 prime, E33 prime, and all the diagonal of the diagonal elements of this tensor will have zero components, will have zero value. So these, and on top of that, E11 prime will be equal to lambda 1, E22 prime will be equal to lambda 2, and E33 prime will be equal to lambda 3. Now you should verify this for yourself. Right. I should also say that even if you are unable to verify this, that's okay. This is something that you should, I'm just telling you without proof, right? And this is not examinable in the sense that there won't be any problems other than for you to calculate the eigenvectors and eigenvalues of the deformation rate tensor. And I say that because these have special names. These are called the principal values of E. These principal values are invariant under rotation of coordinate axes. So in a sense, One thing that we had not taken into account before was the fact that the components of a second rank tensor depend on your choice of the coordinate axis. And as a user, laws of physics being independent of your choice of coordinate axis, you are free to choose any coordinate axis that you like. And a consequence of that became that depending on the coordinate axis you choose, your deformation appeared to be either extension or shear or some combination thereof. But irrespective of your choice, there is always a choice possible which corresponds to the eigenvectors of the deformation rate tensor. If you make that choice of the coordinate system, then you will only have extensional deformation rate tensor, extensional components of the deformation rate tensor. And therefore, you could consider shear as simply a version of extension in a rotated coordinate system. This is the end of the topic, deformation of infinitesimal fluid elements. There is very little beyond this, and the little that there is, we will cover as and when needed. So with that, thank you for your attention, and I will see you in either the next video or in the lecture. Bye.